Hello, this is Craig from bizbox.co.uk. In this video, we are going to be painting Cloud Strife from Final Fantasy VII, or more accurately, from Final Fantasy VII Advent Children. Slightly different to the video game versions, certainly the original one, at least. This is a 54mm scale miniature, and if I just get a little look. Here you can see he's a lot taller than the regular 28mm miniatures that we paint on this channel. This miniature I just found on eBay. Thought it'd be quite a fun little project to paint up for the channel. I have no idea what manufacturer made him, but he's in resin. He went together quite nicely. For Buster Sword, slight bend on it, and I've tried straighten up the best I can without it breaking. But it still looks pretty cool anyway. I've primed him with a grey primer, as I just always like to work with a grey primer, even though this miniature is going to have a lot of dark colours on him. So you may wish to undercoat yours in black if you get hold of one of these, or you want to paint anything in a similar manner. So I'm going to begin with by taking Abaddon Black. And I am going to be base coating pretty much all his clothing with this colour. And I think I'll also paint the Buster Sword as well. So almost everything apart from the skin and hair. So yeah, you could see why it might be better to undercoat him in black. However, I do like to paint black with Avedon Black anyway. You could, of course, airbrush black all over him, which is something I was gonna do, but for purposes of video, I just want to keep everything brush. So you can see, I've thinned out the black a bit, so it's gone on a little bit grey. That's fine, because I'm gonna apply another thin coat, and that'll give us a really nice, smooth black to work from. Okay, so now that we have a lot of these areas painted in black, we're going to move on to the palpable areas. That will be his trousers and also his undershirt there. And to start with, we're going to take some Nagaroth Knight. So it's just a case of applying it over these areas. Now I want this purple to be quite dark, which is why I've painted the Avedon Black on these areas first, so it gives it a nice dark base to work from. But because it's going over black, as always, you'll need two thin coats of this colour. So I've now base coated these purple areas, and as you can see, they're quite dark. And we're going to come back to them though, because first we're going to just paint the base coat on the Buster Sword, starting with some corn red just for the handle. So the reason I am painting this before I finish purple is because I'm just going to do a few colours that are all going to be shaded in exactly the same way. So I'm just painting the red just on here. Next up, I'm going to paint the blade of the Buster Sword, and for this I'm going to take some fresh metal from scale 75. Now you could use Ironbreaker or Lead Belcher for this. I'm just quite a big fan of these metallics, and I do hope to one day do a video showing off these metallics a bit more in the future, maybe comparing them against some other rangers. As you can see, I will need a couple of thin coats of this colour, but I'm just going to paint the remainder of the Buster Sword with it. Okay, so now we're going to shade over all three of these areas, and we're going to take some Null Oil. Now I've watered it down ever so slightly. It might not show up too well on the purple. This is just to give some depth to the little creases and all the details. It will darken this purple down a bit more, but we can brighten that up in a later step. And then same on the red and the metallic areas. Now it's quite a big flat area on the sword, which is why I've watered it down a fair bit, so we don't end up with big black smudges on the actual blade. But we can still get a nice depth to all these detailed areas. Okay, so as you can see, that's left these areas very dark. You'll see the pebble as it catches the light. But we are going to brighten the pebble back up. So we're going to take our Nagaroth Knight once again. And this time we're just going to apply it a bit more focused than before. So essentially, we are going to leave the Nuln oil wash in all the recesses, and we'll just paint all the larger flat areas with this purple. Next step is to highlight all these purple areas, and for this I'm going to take some Xeris purple. So we're looking just to follow all the lines and creases, and that will be easier to show on the trousers. So you see where the folds are there. I'm just going to run a brush along there. As always, I have thinned this colour out so it won't dry as stark. So next up, we're going to concentrate on the sword. As you can see, I've highlighted all these purple areas. You could go and highlight them further if you wish with a lighter purple, but I quite like them how they are with these subtle highlights. Don't want to sort of try and keep them quite dark. And to highlight the red, we're going to take some Evil Sun's Scarlet. So I'm going to thin this down ever so slightly. We don't want this to dry too stark, so by thinning it down, that'll make the highlight a bit more subtle, even though it's quite bright. We could have re-established this red like we did with the purple, but as it's such a small area, I thought it's not really that necessary. There's a very interesting pattern on here. It's quite hard to really see when you're not that up close, so I'm just dotting on little bits of red here and there. Again, as it's so thin, that won't dry this bright. So I'll continue to rest this off camera, and then we'll move on to the metal parts of the sword. Okay, and here is the red. Now I just added an extra little bit so you can see the difference between where it's dry and not dry, so that darkens down quite nicely. So now we're going to move on to the silver, and I'm going to start by taking some heavy metal from scale 75, or you can take some Iron Breaker, very similar colour. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to run it along this blade by turning around, just around the top of the blade. Like so, and this bit here. See, there's not a great deal of difference between these two colours, but it just adds something just a little bit different to it. I don't really need to be in that middle bit there, so I'll just go back over that. And also gonna just hit the top there as well. And of course, we'll do exactly the same on the other side. If you want, you could also hit this rear edge with it, which I think I might do actually. Just to give the centre of the blade a little bit more sort of depth between the colours. So it'll be very subtle when it dries, but that should look quite nice. So now we can move on to just a sharp highlight on this blade. And for that I'm going to take some Stormhost Silver. I'm quite a fan of Stormhost Silver. It's a very, very bright silver and it's great for highlighting metallic areas. So I'm just going to just run the side of my brush just along the blade. All like so. Also a cross for top. And I'm also just going to edge highlight just around the hilt. And I'll also get all these rivets. And this little bit here will be highlighted as well. So with the blade now complete, we can move on to some other areas. So I'm going to start by highlighting all of these black areas. So we have, I would say caper arms, whatever this bit is. And his sleeve and his gloves, or glove I should say, and we also have shoes as well. And to highlight these, I'm simply just going to take some Eschen Grey, and this is quite a nice dark grey, which is really good for highlighting black areas. So as always, I've thinned that out. Now I'm just going to follow the folds of this area here, and also just go around the base of it as well. So it's a very simple stylized way of highlighting. You could of course wet blend, do several glazes. I've got a bit too much on the brush there. I just quite like doing just thin highlights following the folds. Very quick and easy way of doing these highlights, and they still look quite nice once it's all dry. So just take your time and just be very careful to follow all these areas. As always, it always looks quite stark when it goes on, but it will dry bit more subtle as the paint is thin. So as you can see, these highlights are quite subtle. Maybe show up a little bit more in the light. So we can take them just a little bit further with some Dawnstone. This time we're going to be a lot more focused with our highlighting. So essentially I just want to highlight just the top of these areas, just sort of like that. And so up here, for example, just a little bit. And any sort of areas where two highlights meet, certainly want to put a little bit on. I'm only doing a very small amounts. When it comes to the hands, we can just apply, or the hand I should say, because the other one is bare. We just apply just a little bit just on the knuckles. Like so. So with the black areas now complete, we can move on to these straps that go across his front. We're going to start with by taking some dryad bark. So you could use Rhinox Hide if you wish, or any other sort of dark brown colour, but I'm quite a fan of Dryad Bark, so it just has that bit more of a muted grey tone to it. And I think that'll work well with this miniature. So as always, just carefully apply it to these areas, and I've thinned out just so it flows quite smoothly, but it does cover the black really well. So these straps are all going to be given a simple edge highlight of Gore 4 brown. So I'm literally just going to take the side of my brush and just very carefully run it just across these edges here, and that'll just pick them out quite nicely. Obviously be careful not to get any on any of the other areas that I've done already. So I'm going to run it all the way along all these outer edges. Next up, we can go back to our heavy metal from scale 75, and we're just going to paint the buckles on these straps, and also this little sort of like lion's head symbol on his shoulder. Also, I'm just going to put a Nuln oil wash over this once it's dry, but I will do that off camera. So we just get all these little buckles and just very carefully just pick them out like so. So next up we are going to focus on his skin. So to begin with, I'm going to take some Cadian flesh tone, and I'll show you the arm as an example. So as I'm painting his arm, I realised that it looks like he does have a glove sculpted on, so we'll paint that in exactly the same way as the black. Yeah, it's very strange because when you look at it this way, the hand really does look like it's just a regular hand. There's a lot of sort of detail on there like you'd find on a regular hand, but it's obviously part of a glove. So we'll paint that in black, and we will just paint the rest of the skin as a normal. But yeah, as you can see, the Cadian flesh tone is going on quite nicely actually, because just going over where that grey primer was. If you're going over a black primer, you may need two or three, at least two certainly, thin coats. Or you could even base coat them with Bugman's Glow and then work up from there. And of course, there's also the face and the neck. So before we do any more on the skin, I'm going to take some Avaland Sunset, and this is going to base coat his hair. So once this is on, all the base coats at least will be there. So he's very close to completion now. So as always, just be careful not to get any on any areas that you've already painted. Once these two areas are dry, we can shade them both together using some Reikland Flesh Shade. So I'll start on the arm. I'm just applying it all over, and as you can see, it just goes nicely into all these recesses, like so, and same on the hair. Now of course you could use a different colour on the hair if you wish, and you could use a Fugan Orange for example, but I just quite like the sort of reddy orangey colour of the flesh tone. And it just speeds up the process because we can also shade the skin at the same time. Okay, so all that's left now is to highlight these two areas, and we'll start by highlighting the flesh with Kislev Flesh. Okay, so as always, I've thinned it down ever so slightly. And we're looking to paint most of the skin, really. Not all of it, of course. You want to leave this shade settled in the recesses, but I'm hitting the higher parts of the face, like the jawline, cheeks, of course the nose and upper lip. This just adds a nice highlight tattoo of skin. You can actually do most of the forehead. I'll do it a bit more on the cheeks as well. Of course, as always, it looks a lot more stark as it goes on than when it dries, so don't worry too much about how it looks at this stage. And then on the arms, do a similar thing. We'll just follow the muscle lines. The shade has left it a little bit glossy, as you can see it's sort of reflecting off the light, but hopefully you can see it alright. So I'm literally just following these lines like so. So as you can see, the highlights are a little bit softer now on the face. Normally I wouldn't just jump straight into the highlight like that, but these sort of miniatures, especially when you're on that sort of Japanese sort of almost manga style, sometimes it's good to have quite sort of stark, a little bit stark of highlights and deeper shadows. But I don't want to go too overboard with this one. That said, for the hair, I'm going to take some Dawn Yellow. This is certainly brighter than I'd go with, but sort of Cloud's hair is sort of more of a paler yellow on some of the artwork and stuff, certainly the Advent Children style. So we'll see how it looks. I'm not going to go overboard with this highlight. I just want to just sort of catch these raised sort of sharp points. Again, I have thinned it down so it won't dry this bright. The brush just down the hair like so. So I'll go around the whole hair and we'll see how it looks once it's dried. Okay, so I've applied the Dawn Yellow now and I actually think it looks alright. I do quite like them highlights. However, if you're not a fan of that and you don't want something to bright, I'm gonna do one more thing to them. And that's to take a glaze of Lamenta's Yellow, and this will just make them just go a little bit more yellow. So yeah, as I said, I wouldn't normally just jump straight into that sort of highlight, but I was quite interested to see how it would look. And I'm also actually quite interested to see how this Lamenta's Yellow glaze will look on top. So there's that risk that some of these darker areas will look a little bit green, but hopefully when it dries, and that won't be so bad. As you can see, it does help just bring these highlights together with the main hair colour. And if you do find it looking a little bit green in the recesses, you can just get a dry paintbrush and sort of just sponge it up, so to speak. What I like to do whenever I have paint that's too runny, or I just want to get rid of shade that settles too much in recesses. So once that dry, we only have one thing left to do, and that's just to paint his eyes. So to paint his eyes, I'm just going to take some white scar, and this is where we need have a very steady hand. I'll try and do it on camera as best as I can. Let me literally just paint in the eyes like so. Now I'm not too worried about painting in any eyeballs and pupils like that. Even on a model at this scale, I can just get in there. That's not perfect, but don't look too bad. Yeah, I mean, you could paint in little black dots for the eyes if you wish, but I think I'll just leave them there, because again, they're only like tiny little white dots. So with that, the Cloud miniature is complete and you can base him however you want. I've just left his base black for now. And here is the finished Cloud miniature. So it's a really nice miniature, not like the most highly detailed miniature in the world. It's not like the same level you'd expect from a Games Workshop miniature, but it really represents Cloud very well. And, you know, it's still got some good detail on him. He's been really, really fun to paint. And I hope you've enjoyed watching me paint him in this video. So, as always, if you have enjoyed this video, you can give it a thumbs up. And you can also subscribe to our YouTube channel if you haven't done so already. We also have a Patreon where you can watch some videos early for as little as $1. There's also some exclusive videos going up there as well, so be sure to look out for them. All that's left to say is thank you so much for watching, and I will see you all again very soon.